So yeah, let's talk about little bit about synchronous machine more, and then we'll go to the problem solving. So if you see synchronous machine, then we saw that the equivalent circuit is something like this. This is your field. This is your field current. This is armature. This is EF, synchronous reactance, armature resistance, and this is the output of the synchronous machine or the input of synchronous machine, depending on whether it is operating as motor or as a generator, right? Now, where all are losses happening? So there is losses in stator copper loss, right? What is stator copper loss? The losses happening in resistance. Losses happening in resistance, RA, right? Because armature is on stator, so that is I1 square RA, where I1 is, let's say, current flowing in this winding, right? Then we also have rotor copper loss, which is IF square RF, right? Then we have core loss. Would there be core loss? Would there be core loss in rotor, in stator? Rotor, core loss, no core loss in rotor, right? In stator, yes, there is a core loss. So core loss mostly in stator, which will have some value. Then we'll have friction loss and other mechanical loss, right? So these are the different types of losses that would happen in this machine. And now, depending on whether it is operating as a motor or rotor, the sequence in which these losses would get applied to the input power would change, right? Similar to the induction machine, in the equivalent circuit, there is no component which represents the core loss, right? Similar to induction machine, in the equivalent circuit, there is no component. There is no R parallel which represents the core loss. And therefore, here also core loss would be added and subtracted along with the mechanical losses, right? So in some of the problems you see it may be coupled also. So in this case, what is the power that is getting converted from electrical to mechanical? That is the power that is getting absorbed by the element EF. The power absorbed by the element EF is the power that is getting converted from electrical to mechanical energy. Power, electrical to mechanical, is the power absorbed or supplied, if power is going from mechanical to electrical, in source EF, right? So let's say we think of it as a generator. In that case, what is the sequence? The sequence is, first you have prime mover power, right? Or you have prime mover, or from prime mover power, then you would subtract mechanical loss, you would subtract the core loss. Then what you would remain with is the power mechanical to electrical. And then you subtract the stator copper loss. And if you want to find the efficiency, then you also should subtract the rotor copper loss. And this would give you the net electrical sorry, it will give you the net electrical output, right? The only thing is that sometimes you sort of not include the rotor copper loss, right? Because the output you usually see in terms of the AC power, right? So if you are looking at output in terms of the AC power, then you don't go till this step and you only say this is the output AC power, right? So keep that in mind. And if question asks you what is the output AC power, right? Then you don't subtract the rotor copper loss. Usually, most of the cases, then the question would not even bother you to present you with data related to the rotor copper loss, right? So, sort of. But then, yeah, if you have been asked for net electrical output, what is the net electrical output? You are producing AC, but you are also consuming some amount of DC power. So it should be the output AC that you are producing minus the DC power that you are consuming, right? So that should be the net electrical output. But if somebody asks you specifically what is the output on the AC side or what is the AC output and something like that, then you neglect that part. And now if you talk about motor, then you go reverse direction, right? Then you first you add both the powers, the DC power, the AC power becomes your input. Then you have rotor copper loss, stator copper loss. Then you have frictional core loss. Then you have friction loss. And then you have mechanical output. Any doubt? Yeah.
The rotational losses and frictional losses, same thing.
Yes. So other rotational loss was part of mechanical losses. Everything we have put them, and it could be frictional loss, windage loss, mechanical loss, right? If you see some of the literature, right, especially in induction machine, then the rotational loss was mentioned that it includes both core loss and mechanical loss, right? So it may so happen that the rotational loss may actually include both the losses also. Any other doubt? Okay. Yeah, so with that, I think now have some of you tried the tutorial problem, last tutorial? Some of you, okay. Were you able to solve it? Good. So I think there will be one or two questions related to efficiency that also now you should be able to solve it. So now, if you understand, I've already shared with you that in our grid, we have multiple right. Let's say this is our grid, and in our grid we would have multiple synchronous generators connected at different point, right? There could be a power generation happening close to Delhi, a right? Place called Dadri. There is an NTPC power plant. Then there is another NTPC power plant in Faridabad, which is a gas-based power plant, right? Then you have another NTPC. There are a lot of them, right? One is there near Kota. So there are a lot of these power generation plants, right? All of them would have either one or multiple synchronous generators, right? So you can understand that at any point of time, there may be hundreds of, if not hundreds, at least tens to hundred of synchronous generator operating in our grid to provide us power. So now the question is, how do we connect a new generator? Let's say now everything is set up, everything is working. Now I want to add one more generator, right? I shut it down for whatever reasons, for maintenance or there was no demand or something. Now I want to connect it back to the grid, right? So how can I connect a synchronous machine back to the grid? What are the options that we have here? So if you see in power plant, the synchronous machine would have a prime mover, which would try to sort of rotate the shaft, right? And which you can probably control using some valve or something, right? So you can always shut down that prime mover. You can always remove any force getting applied onto that shaft. So now, can we do this? Can we close these switches? This is grid, right? And this is a synchronous machine. So can we close these switches? Synchronous machine is in a standstill. So can we close these switches and let it operate as a motor for some time, and then open the valve, let there be some torque on the mechanical side, and then it would start acting as a generator. Right? You have two options. One is that you first rotate the shaft, right, using prime mover, and you produce some output power, electrical voltages, right, and then you connect to the grid. The other option is that you don't produce anything at the output electrical. You first connect it to the grid, let this thing operate as a motor, and then you open the valve so that you can produce power and power will start flowing back. Right? So option one is operate as motor, then open, or then you provide the prime mover, and then we also have option two, where we first provide prime mover, which would imply that you operate at some speed, omega rotor, and then connect to grid. You see, I've shown you some switches, S, right? So these combination of switches can be closed, can be open, right? So let's see if option one is possible. Can we go with option one? What are the pros and cons of going with option one? If you want to go with option one, there are a few things. First is that this synchronous machine must have sufficient number of damper windings. Why? Because it will not start. Right? Synchronous machine will not start with direct grid 50 hertz and the supply. Right? So it should have sufficient damper windings which provide sufficient torque for it to start rotating. Right? That is one. Second thing is that you cannot use power electronics here. Why? Because we are not talking about few kilowatt. We are talking about megawatt of power. Right? You understand, right? Kilowatt, megawatt. For example, full campus is about 8 megawatt. These plants, generating plants, a single may be much more than our full campus power, right? So you cannot afford to have power electronics in the main circuit there, right? So even till now, there is no power electronics in the main circuit there. Just for this purpose, you don't want to have a power electronics there, right? So then the only option is you'd go for a line start, right? So this is, in a way, you are going for a line start. With line start, you need damper winding. Anyways, you would usually have damper windings in the generator for the reason they are called damper windings, right? But here you may need maybe a little bit more power capability of damper winding so that it can start the, it can overcome the static torque and it can start the machine. That is one point. The second point is that when it starts, it would draw, because it is starting as an induction machine, right? What happens if you start an induction machine, direct line start induction machine? It draws high current. Why? Because slip is 1. Slip is 1, the resistance is very small, right? So it draws large current. Again, drawing large current in our small air conditioner motor is acceptable. But you imagine, anyways, it's few megawatt of generator. Now it starts drawing large current from the grid. So the grid would actually have to supply a lot of current to start this generator. May not be a very good way. If we don't have any other option, probably we'll go with that, but not the best way of doing it, right? Yeah, so usually you don't go by this method. You don't use option one, right? Because for these limitations, you go with option two. Option two, what you do is you open the prime mover, right? Let it rotate. Once the speed sort of reaches close to the synchronous speed, right? Obviously, you would have measurement instruments so you can connect the, you can measure the speed of the shaft, right? You know the number of poles, right? You know what is the frequency on the grid side, right? So you can adjust your speed so that your synchronous speed is matched to the grid frequency. What do I mean by that? Let me just draw this figure again. So So now these two things, the frequency here and the speed here, is related by n is 120 f by p, right? And let's say this is frequency of synchronous machine, this is my, n is the speed, and this is the frequency of grid. So first step that you do is you start rotating it, right? And you can control the valve, and you may have some speed measurement. Using the speed measurement, you can estimate what is the kind of frequency that are going to get generated here, right? And if you want to close this circuit, then you want the frequencies on both the sides to be same, right? So you can adjust that valve, right? And by adjusting that valve, you can probably get close, make sure that this F sim gets close to the F grid. Is that okay? But you may not be 100% accurate, right? You may still have, let's say, you're talking about 50 hertz, so it may still be, let's say, 49.6 hertz and 49.7 hertz on one side. So you can still have errors as small as these. It may not be very, very accurate, but you would still roughly get very close to the speed of the grid. Is that okay? Now, few things that you need before you close this switch, few things needs to be checked. First is the frequency same? Are both the frequencies on both the sides are same? Second thing which you need to check is, what about the voltage magnitude on both sides? That also should be same. And third thing is the phase sequence. Again, should be same. Phase sequence means it should not happen, let's say A phase wire of this side, I'm connecting to B phase wire of this side, right? A should get connected to A, B should get connected to B, C should get connected to C. So I need to make sure that all three of them should be matching, then only I should close this switch. What happens if I don't match them? Let's say frequencies are not the same. If I close this switch, what happens? Suddenly large amount of power would flow, right? Of beat frequency, difference of the frequency. If the voltage magnitudes are not same, again, if I connect them, suddenly large current will flow, right? It's like you are shorting two voltage sources of different magnitude. So, and same thing is phase sequence is different, means always there's a large difference between A phase of this and B phase of this, right? So you want all of these things to be same, then only you close this switch. Technically, you call this a synchronization, right? You call it synchronization. And a technique which is very popularly used for this is a very basic method which is called as synchronizing lamps. Very basic method, you don't need to spend a lot of money, but then it's very, very effective in ensuring all the three conditions before we connect to the grid. The connection looks something like this. You still have synchronous machine. You have three outputs. You have three switches. And this is your grid. And you connect one bulb across each of the switch. Therefore, it's called as synchronizing lamps. So you connect one incandescent lamp across each of the switch. So what will happen? These lamps may glow. They may not glow. They may glow. They may oscillate, they may grow bright light, they may grow with the dim light. So all of these things would give us indication of if 1, 2 or 3 is matched or not matched, right? Let's go one by one. Let's take the first case. The frequency is same, right? Let's say we assume that 2 and 3 are okay, only there is a problem with 1, right? So if there's a problem with 1, what will be the voltage across lamp? Voltage across lamp will be the voltage of synchronous generator V1 and the frequency of the synchronous generator minus the voltage of the grid, assume that voltage is matched, magnitude is matched, and the frequency of the grid is different. Oh, sorry, should we take cos? I think we should take cos because we have been taking cos for voltage. Yeah, let's take cos. Is that okay? Right? So if you see, this is going to be the voltage appearing across lamp of A phase. Right? This is going to be the voltage across lamp of A phase. If you simplify it, what will it look like? V1 cos A minus cos B, which will be minus 2 times sine of A plus B by 2 into sine of A minus B by 2. Right? This is the voltage appearing across lamp of A phase. Let me further simplify it. V lamp 2 V1. I am just rewriting the same expression. If you see this first term, omega 1 plus omega 2 by 2. What is that? You add the frequency of grid plus the frequency of synchronizer, you divide it by 2. I already told you that by using basic speed measurements, you are close to grid. You are not very off. So maybe grid is at 50, you are at 49.6, let's say. Right? Then if you take the average, what do you get? 49.8. Right? So if one of them is 49.6 and the other one is 50, and if you take the average, you get 49.8. For the time being, let's not look at the last value. Let's see only this first term. If you see this first term, let's say this is the only, that is the voltage getting applied to an incandescent bulb. What will you see? The bulb sees a voltage magnitude of 2V1, right? So 2V1 means V1 is the voltage, rated voltage, so which is quite bright. Right? It's not that you are seeing a very low voltage. So it's a bright glow. And do you see any oscillations in the bulb? Would you observe any oscillations in their brightness? Is it going like tip, 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 tip? No? Because this frequency is of the order of 50 Hz, right? So you would just see with your eyes as glowing regularly. Right? So glowing regularly with a very significant magnitude. Now, if you see this second term, what is this? This is the difference of the frequency, right? So now if it is again 49.6 and 50, then what is the difference? 0.4 Hertz. Now because the second term is there, if you see the bulb, it will not be of continuous bright light because these are very low frequency oscillations, right? So you would be able to see bulb glowing to coming to the brightest light possible and then again going dim and becoming almost dark, complete dark. Right, then again glowing and then again coming back, again glowing and again coming back. Is that okay? So if you see these low oscillation of that bulb, right, you understand there is a problem with frequency. So what you do is now you again adjust the valve such that you can match the frequency. Right? So there are these three problems have three different signatures on the lamp. Light, right? So if you're looking at the signature, you can figure out which problem is that. Let's see at the second problem. What was the second problem? The second problem was voltage magnitude, right? What if there's a mismatch in voltage magnitude? Any doubts so far? What if there's a mismatch in voltage magnitude? Assume all the other things are correct, only there's a mismatch in voltage magnitude. So V lamp of let's say A phase is V1 cos of omega 1 t minus V2 cos of same frequency omega 1 t. Right? So this will give you V1 minus V2 this is the voltage that lamp would see. What does this mean? The lamp would glow very dim, right? But continuous, right? There are no oscillations because omega 1 is of 50 hertz, 2 pi 50 hertz. And V1 minus V2 is usually small because you have some rough idea, right? That, okay, if I give so much of field current, then my voltage would be approximately same as grid voltage, right? So this thing is, let me write first for this one. So if you see, this full expression gives oscillation in bulb brightness, and this is continuous low brightness bulb. What do you do if this is the case? If it is glowing with a very low intensity but continuously glowing, what do you adjust? You adjust the field current, right? By adjusting the field current, you can adjust the open circuit voltage, right? As of now, whatever is the voltage appearing is the open circuit voltage, right? So by adjusting the field current, excuse me, you can adjust the open circuit voltage. Any doubt? Let's go to the third problem, which is phase sequence. What if the phase sequences are different, right? Let's say you physically connected A here, but you connected B on the other side of the switch, right? So if you happen to close it, then there'll be large current. So if the phase sequences are different, then let's say what you see is lamp of A phase would actually see V1 cos of omega 1t from this side. And let's say from the grid side is actually phase B. So it sees minus V1 cos of omega 1t minus 120, right? Then what happens? You can take V1 common, you apply cos A minus cos B, which is minus 2 times sine of A plus B by 2, which is omega 1t minus 60 degrees into sine of A minus B by 2, which is sine of 60 degrees. Right? So if you simplify this, you get minus 2V1 sine of omega 1t minus 60 degrees. And what is, how much is sine 60? Root 3 by 2. Right? So you multiply here by root 3 by 2. And this gets cancelled out. Now what do you see? Fairly good bright because it's V1 times root 3 and continuous glow again. Right? So if it is continuously glowing with a good brightness, that means you did the mess up in terms of phase sequence. So what do? You open the exchange the wires, right? And you see if you are able to match the phase sequence. Is that okay? Any doubt so far? So using these three, you can actually figure out how to connect synchronous generator. How do you go about it? You start from step three, right? So you connect the circuit, you observe bulb. First thing is, if you observe a very bright light, continuous bright light, that means something is seriously wrong. So you interchange the phase sequence. Now that continuous bright light is gone, right? Then you check step two. Then you see whether you have a continuous low brightness light. Do you have continuous low brightness light or the light is never going to zero? That means you have a problem with voltage magnitude. You adjust the field. Then you see, okay, voltage magnitude is going zero. But then it comes up and then it again goes back zero. So it's like very slowly changing, right? Then what do? You try to adjust the frequency using the wall. But then the walls are mechanical settings, right? So you can only go up till a far. You cannot make it perfect. But you make it to that far that when the bulb goes dark, it stays dark for sufficient time. So that means the frequency has become, difference of the frequency, the beat frequency has become really, really low. And now when do you close? When the bulb is glowing or the bulb is dark? When do you go? When the bulb is glowing or the bulb is dark? When the bulb is dark. Why? Because when the bulb is dark, that means the voltage potential across these two is zero. So you close at that instant, right? When the bulb is glowing, that means there is a sufficient voltage difference between these two, right? You don't close at that point. So you close it when the bulb is dark. Is that okay? Right? So this is, the whole process is called as synchronizing lamp, and it is called as synchronization of the synchronous machine with the grid. And that's how you connect a synchronous machine to the grid. Good. Yeah, you would know, you would read more things about synchronous machine in E330, right? So I would leave it for that. Let's do some problems, starting from some basic problems. So the question says, 208 volt star connected synchronous motor is drawing an armature current of 50 ampere at unity power factor. UPF stands for unity power factor. That means power factor is equal to 1, right? So let me draw the equivalent circuit. This is EF. This is synchronous reactance, armature resistance. This is V1. I can take V1 at an angle 0. I can take EF at an angle delta. And it says power factor is unity. So now the question is, what is, where power factor is unity? Is angle between IA and V1 is 0, or the angle between IA and EF is 0? Is the angle between IA and EF is 0, or is the angle between IA and V1 is 0? IA and V1, all of you agree? Why? Because the question says this machine is operating at unity power factor. So EF is something which is inside machine, right? What you can measure is the external terminal voltage and the terminal current. So when you say this is, or this load is operating at unity power factor, that means this load seen by the grid or seen by the source is operating at unity power factor, right? Yeah. So IA is also at an angle 0 in this case. Next, the question says that it is also getting supplied from a same source of 208 volts. So that means what is the value of V1? Value of V1 is 208 upon root 3. Why? Because this is three phase motor, we would always specify line to line values, right? Phase value is 208 by root 3. This is the magnitude of V1. I can assume V1 at an angle 0. Because one of the thing I can consider as reference. Now it also gives you information that the field current is 2.7 ampere. The field current is 2.7 ampere for these conditions. And you have been also given the value of excess, which is 0.8 ohm. And nothing is talked about RA, so I would consider RA is 0. No, so you, whenever there is a three-phase system, whether it is star connected, delta connected, whenever there is a three-phase system, and if we tell you that the voltage is 400 volt or 50 volt or 60 volt, that voltage is always line-to-line voltage. And the equivalent circuit is always per phase equivalent circuit, right? So the line-to-line voltage in this case and the phase voltage in this case would have a magnitude difference of root 3. In delta, usually if it is the per phase equivalent circuit is given with respect to delta, then it will not be the case. Yes, in delta it will not be the case, because whatever is the applied voltage would be equal to the voltage appearing across each phase of that equivalent circuit, right? Yeah. Just to sort of save you from little confusion, it is very difficult, because since you asked this question, then I'm just recalling back. the questions which I read from all of these books and I did from all of these books, everyone had star connection, right? So, but yeah, if you can find a question in delta, then that is how you should approach about that problem. Any other question? Okay. What else is given? Yeah, another information that is given is you assume linear open circuit characteristics. You assume linear open circuit characteristics. Linear OCC. What do you mean by linear OCC? EF versus IF graph is straight line. Right? So if you double IF, your EF will also become double. And vice versa. Yeah, it may not. So when you say linear OCC, you consider it from origin. So that you double IF, you EF becomes double. Is that okay? Okay, now let's see the question. Part A asks you, find the torque angle. Find the torque angle. What is torque angle? Torque angle is also known as rotor angle. Sometimes it's also known as power angle. And it is equal to delta as shown in the figure, right? And you should report it with the sign, right? Not just the magnitude, because sign plays a lot of difference. If it's plus or minus, the power may actually be flowing in reverse directions, right? So it's known by different names. Torque angle is the most popular one, but yeah, you may see other values also. You understand the power factor angle, we would represent it by theta, right? Which is the angle between IA and V1, right? That is the angle which defines the power factor. And this is the angle which defines the torque angle, which is the angle difference between the both voltage sources. So there's a difference between delta and theta, right? You can always express them in form of each other, which we'll do as a part of next question, and they are different. Any doubt? Okay. Yeah. So do we have sufficient information to solve for question number A? Find the torque angle, right? We know the grid voltage V1 angle 0. We know excess. We know the current that is flowing, right? So we know the grid voltage V1. We know the current that is flowing, that is also in the same direction, IA, power factor is unity, right? So if I see the voltage drop across excess would be like this, right? It's an inductive element, so current would be lagging the voltage. And now if I say what is EF at an angle delta, that will be summation of vector V1 minus V of excess. So this is minus V of excess, and if I add them, then I get my resultant vector, which is EF vector. If I get EF vector, you get both magnitude as well as the angle, torque angle, right? Even if you have given a value of RI, you can still solve it, right? Is this okay? Do you want me to draw it again? I just drawn it a little bit smaller. Do you want me to draw it again? Anyone? Okay. Part A is done. Answer, you guys are noting down the values, and I can also give you answer. Answer you should get is minus 18.4 degrees. This problem is from Chapman, so you can always refer to that book also. Part B. How much field current would be required to make the motor operate at 0.78 power factor leading? How much IF? Just think about it, because this is Very simple, very straightforward, but you just have to think about it and then you should be able to solve it. So the question has given one case. The case was that this machine was operating as a motor. It was operating at unity power factor. It was drawing certain current and it had certain value of field current. Now the question says that how much field current should be changed to such that the same motor in the same setup now starts drawing power at a power factor of 0.78 power factor leading. So now the question is that what remains constant? Is IA constant? Should I consider that IA is the same? Because essentially if you see, I have already solved for this circuit, so I know the previous value of EF, right? Let's say this is now the new value of EF and the new value of delta. And this is V1 angle 0. And now it is said that this current is at an angle theta where cos theta is 0.78. And it is a plus angle. So current is at plus because power factor is leading, right? So the question is that the question to you is that what would you consider constant? Would you consider IA to be same as that of previous case? Nothing is given in the question. So if you assume IA to be same in the previous case, then solving it is the same, right? You just quickly solve for new value of EF prime and new value of delta prime. The new value of EF prime upon old value of EF prime would give you the new value of IF prime upon the old value of IF prime, right? So EF prime upon EF is equal to IF prime upon IF. So the whole problem is actually to find this EF prime. Once you know this, you will get IF prime. But question is that should you consider IA to be constant while calculating this new value of EF prime? Yes? No? What should you consider constant in these two cases? Complex power. Why? Complex power is definitely, but yeah, why do you think complex power should be constant?
The machine is the same.
Yeah, but then, okay, maybe let's see, let's hear from others also and then we'll conclude. What about others? What do you think, what would remain constant? Can I remain constant or what should? If you're saying complex power is constant, then IA is constant essentially. Right? Yeah. What about other, any other opinion? It's the same setup. If this would have been an induction motor question, it would have been a little bit more tricky. Synchronous machine is a little bit easier to think. You see, you change something, right? Unless you are changing the frequency, your speed is not changing. Agree? Frequency is definitely not changing of the grid. So that means speed is not changing. There is some mechanical load connected. That mechanical load will have some torque speed characteristics. If you are not changing the speed of that mechanical load, the torque of that mechanical load is also not changing. So the power drawn by the mechanical load is not changing. If this would have been an induction machine, things story would have been different. Why? Because slip may change. Slip may change means output speed may change. Output speed may change means the load torque may change. Or even if the torque is constant, torque into speed, power will change. But here frequency is same, speed is same, load torque would remain the same because we have not mentioned anything changing in the load side. So the load power is the same. Assuming neglecting losses, RA anyways is not given, any other losses are also not given. So that means the input real power remains the same. Is that okay? The input real power remains the same. I'll write it. So frequency is same implies no change in N. Mechanical implies no change in load torque, same speed, same load, so nothing changes there, implies no change in output mechanical power. Since no losses component are given here, we can assume no change in input real power. Implies V1 IA cos theta is equal to V1. V1 remains the same. Ia prime cos theta prime. Right? That is the real power. Sorry, into 3. Right? Which implies that you can find the value of Ia prime as Ia cos theta was 1 upon cos theta prime, which is 0.78. So you get the value of Ia prime. Once you know the current, once you know Ia prime magnitude, you know anyways know the angle, then you can solve and find EF prime. Once you know EF prime, you know IF prime. Right? So the answer is IF prime is equal to 3.35 ampere. Any doubt? In this tutorial, if some of you have attempted, because accordingly I can take the question, is there any question where the synchronous machine is coupled mechanically to maybe a DC machine or induction machine? There are some questions like that, right? Yeah. So that means you then understand what this coupling means, because then you can couple any two machines, right? You can couple an induction machine to a DC machine. You can couple a synchronous machine to a DC machine. I think there may be more problems on that, either in Chapman or in PCSAN. So you also look at those problems, right? Because that sort of, that problem gives you a really clear picture of how things are happening. So I had two questions. So I'll not take that coupled question. I'll go with the other question, right? Because that question is anyways there in the tutorial. So, and if you're not able to solve it, you ask tutor. If you're not able to solve it still, then anyways, we are meeting on Friday, so we can discuss that question. Now the next problem says the derive equation for torque angle delta as a function of synchronous reactance, armature resistance, current that you are drawing from the grid voltage, and the power factor angle theta. Find the expression for delta, which is the torque angle, in terms of these things. So you see, XS and RA are machine parameters, right? You would know how, what are the values of machine parameters. IA you can measure because it's the terminal current. V1 you can measure because it is the grid voltage. Theta also you can measure, power factor, right? You can have a wattmeter, current measurement, voltage measurement, you can find the power factor. Delta is something which you cannot measure, right? Why? Because it is the angle of the inside voltage source. So then you need to calculate it, right? So how do you calculate it? You can... Let me draw, the reason I'm doing it is because it's not in terms of values, it is in terms of expressions. So you see, you start with the voltage V1, which is at an angle 0, right? This is your voltage V1 at an angle of 0. This is your equivalent circuit anyways. So you start with this voltage, and if you see V1, let's say this is voltage drop across let's say current is flowing in this direction, and it is at an angle of power factor theta with respect to V1. We know theta, right? So it is, let's say, leading and at an angle of theta. So if I assume my current is going inside at an angle of theta, right? Let's say this may be operating as a motor at that instant, or value of IA may be negative. So I'm just taking a general case. What will be the voltage drop across RA? The voltage drop across RA would be in the same direction as that of IA. So this is my voltage drop across RA. So this is IA into RA, right? Which is VRA, and I have V excess. What is V excess? V excess would be in this direction, 90 degrees to the current, V excess. Is that okay? Right? So now what is my EF at an angle delta? EF at an angle delta is given by V1 at an angle 0 minus V RA vector minus V excess vector. Right? So where is minus V RA vector? V RA vector would go something like this. This is my minus IARA vector, right? What is this angle? This angle is also theta, right? From the geometry, you can see this angle is also theta. And what is V axis? V axis is going in this direction. So what is V axis? V axis is, sorry, V axis is this, but again, I have to do a minus. So not this way. Minus of Vxs would be in this direction. This is minus of Vxs. And what will you lead to? This thing will result you to vector EF angle delta. So that means this angle is delta, right? And this is 90 degrees. Is this phasor diagram okay? Any doubt in this phasor diagram? Obviously, if you consider IA in the other direction, then this phasor diagram would change. But that's fine. The final expression you would get there also, you can substitute IA with minus IA and everything would be the same. Now, the question is, what is angle delta? So, we can write tan delta is vertical upon base. Right? So, let's say this is the point. Let me use a different color pen. I'll just take one more minute. Use a different color pen. It need not fall at the end edge of V1, right? So although in this figure it looks like that it is falling at the edge of V1, but V1 edge is here, and this may fall not necessarily at the edge of V1, right? So what is the vertical height? The vertical height is minus IARA. So anyways, magnitude is negative. So tan delta is tan of magnitude of delta. I'm defining delta in this way, right? So it is IA into RA into sine of theta plus IA into excess into cos of theta. That is the vertical height of that line, right? This vector, excess vector into cos of theta will give you this much of height, and the other vector into sine of theta will give you the remaining height. Upon the base, which is, what is the base? Base is V1 minus, so base is the base projection of EF, which is V1 minus IARA cos theta plus IA excess sin theta. Is that okay? Just go back and just check for the signs. I hope we have not done any mistake, but still go back and check, right, if you have made any mistake. So this you get the general expression of torque. Okay.